Welcome to another episode of Real Time Quest. Our today's guest has been through 25 years of corporate lifestyle, worked in Britannia, United Breweries and MCDowells, and also Enfield India. He has worked in all these companies and also through a financial sector company. And then he entered into real estate. Mainly he was focused into residential real estate and gone through ups and downs of all the real estate from 2000 to 2017. And I'm honored to have him on the show. He's Ashok.
Yeah, sir. Thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you, Vamsi.
So starting off with your start. You have started out your career in corporate lifestyle.
Yes.
And eventually you got into real estate. So can you just brief out how the things turned out to be?
Yeah, I worked in the corporate world for about 25 years. I have worked in companies like Britannia Biscuits, United Breweries, McDowell and Company, Enfield India. And lastly, I was heading a financial services company, All India. After my stint in the financial services company, I was compelled to come out and do my own business because of personal reasons, for family reasons. So I came outside, I came back to Chennai. I was thinking what kind of business I should get into. I tried my hand at many businesses. Not only real estate, which we are talking about now. I must say that each business that I got into was very interesting. It had its own pluses and minuses. I started by selling, mineral water in those days was not very popular.
Yeah. So what was the time generally like? Can you give me an approximate year, like 1990? Is it from 1990s or?
This probably about 98.
Okay.
And thereafter, I found that even water business was not really taking off. I was a fairly good cook. I decided to get into the food business.
Okay.
I decided that I will give good food at a reasonable cost.
Okay.
But only delivery. No sitting and eating. So we only non-veg.
Okay.
No vegetarian. Because vegetarian there are plenty in the city. So I said, we used to make good chapatis, chicken curry, and biryani.
Okay.
Only these three items, nothing else.
Three
chapatis, chicken curry, I used to give in those days for 35 rupees, which was an excellent price.
Yeah.
Because you can't get idli vada today for that price. So it went out very well. I called my company Swad. Swad means taste.
Yeah.
So it became so popular that we were recognized by the food critic Rashmi Uday Singh. She's a food critic in the Hindu. So she came, she interviewed me and my mother. And there was a half page article in the Hindu on the kind of food that we were giving to the public. The only thing was this was totally dependent on delivery boys. So we had about 12 boys who were going around in a radius of about 8 to 10 kilometers max.
So those days it was cycles, right? So or it was bike?
Cycle and bike, both.
Okay.
And they were delivery. But then to manage these boys was very difficult.
Okay, one doubt. So why were you only stuck to delivery? Why not a normal place like sitting and eating? Why?
The normal place sitting and eating is a 24/7 job. You will not have time for anything else.
Okay.
Here I was only giving dinner. Nothing else.
Oh, only dinner.
Only dinner. So chapati, chicken curry and biryani only in the night. From 7 o'clock to 10 o'clock.
So how did you market in that point of time, 1990s?
Appetizing.
Okay.
Word of mouth, taste. People, once they taste what we give, were telling others, Swat food is excellent. Why don't you go?
Mm.
That's how we became very popular. Even today, even though I'm not doing the business, if you say Swat, people will know about me. That's how it is. So, that is how I started in the food business. Then we stopped because of delivery boys. And that's when I was looking at various other opportunities, what kind of business I should get into. At that point of time, my cousin, who's the chairman of an airlines in France,
okay,
he came to India. He said, I want to buy a property. He wanted to buy a flat.
Okay.
He said, can you just help me and look around? So I went and looked around for properties. I saw a lot of properties I saw. And we zeroed down on about four properties. One of them was in Poets Garden. It's a two-bedroom, 1,400 square feet. And at that point of time, it was about 32 lakhs. So, we finalized that property. And after the finalization, my cousin came and he gave me 1 lakh of rupees. I said, why? He said, no, if somebody else had done it, I would have given him that money. So, I'm giving it to you. So, that was a bonus which came to me without my really thinking that it will come.
Okay.
Then I thought, why not make it a business? That's how I started my foray into real estate. That's how I got into real estate.
Okay.
And full time I was doing real estate business. I continue to do real estate business even today. That's how it is.
So, if you if you take the beginning of the career, like your career in United Breweries and Enfield India. So, how challenging was the job in Britannia and all those places? How challenging was
it? Any corporate, like what did it include? Any corporate business, the role will always be challenging. It depends on how you take it. You can, as a person, you can either be a mediocre performer or you can be a high level performer. When you are a high level performer, it is a challenge. You can't sit laid back and then expect things to happen. It's not possible. So, you have to take it as a challenge and perform. That's applicable even today in the business. Unless you take any anything that you do as a challenge, you cannot excel in that. That's how I took all my businesses.
Okay, so United Breweries and all this, so were you mainly in FMCG or? Okay, how about finance? How different was it in, coming up to finance?
Ultimately, finance also we were selling.
Okay.
See, we, ultimately you have to sell to people. The kind of finance that we were doing was, it was called chit fund business. And you collect from 10 people and give it to one person. There is an auction in between. But then, that is very easy. It's not very difficult. But collecting that money back from those people is what is very difficult. And we were there for about 7-8 years. It was it, from 0 to 120 crores we achieved. And then we had to come out for various reasons.
Okay.
That's how it happened.
So, immediately then you got it. Next was real estate, I mean the food and other business, and then you got into real estate, right?
I got into real estate.
Comparing both real estate and corporate lifestyle, how different were they? What were the advantages and disadvantages you found that were more affecting your life, the changes and everything?
See, both have their advantages, both have their disadvantages. Corporate lifestyle is different. To the extent that there is a hierarchy. You work in that hierarchy, and there is a set pattern of work, and you work in that process, workflow process itself is different. You are governed by the management, whereas in the real estate business, you are the owner, you are the pune, you are the you are everything. So, success or failure of your company will depend only on you, nobody else.
So, what did you learn, out of all the experiences?
I learned that all businesses cannot be done by the same person.
Okay.
Certain businesses are not meant for you.
Like it's all about self-awareness. Is that the way you can?
Yes.
You can.
So I understood, but I liked the food business. Unfortunately, there were a lot of other personal reasons why I could not continue with the food business. Otherwise, I would have continued with food business. Food business is good business. See, that is not an everlasting demand. Today, youngsters, especially those who are married, they don't want to cook in the house. They want to eat outside. So, morning, both are working. Morning, they go, they have their breakfast somewhere and then they push off for work. Evening, they come, they buy something and come. So, that's how it works. Or they come back home and they, if somebody can deliver, nothing like it. So, food business is good business. But then, once I got into real estate, I didn't get into anything else. Real estate is a good business. So, once I got into real estate, I did not look back. I didn't want to try anything else.
Okay.
So, I full-time 100% in real estate. That's how...
Okay, that was one aspect. You wanted, I mean, you understood that real estate was something suitable for you and it was good for you also.
So, real estate is, I find it's a good business because you look at other businesses, you look at a lawyer. Lawyer, unless there's a lot of criminal activity, that's his business. So, a doctor, a lot of sickness, that's his business. Whereas we as realtors, we give prosperity to people. We can give them a house. So, I think it's a good business.
Okay, that was one side. So, there is one side where you did business and there was one side, I mean, where you got in real estate. There are two different places. But in the middle, if you take something at the age of 50, where you are trying to explore in different businesses, exactly speaking, you go, I mean, more in depth. So, how was your family's response? Because you are trying to experiment at the age of 50, that's something not feasible for many people, actually.
See, I have never felt my age.
Okay.
Today, I'm 67.
Yeah. Which you don't seem to be.
I still don't feel that I am 67.
Even we.
Why should you feel that?
Yeah.
You have to think young. You have to... Only if you think young, you can perform well.
Yeah.
Once you think you're old and you can't do anything, then you're finished. That means your body takes a beating.
Yeah.
And you become slow in everything. I am not slow in anything. I'm fast. I ensure that I am fit and by God's grace, I hope I am fit until the end of my life. I will keep running till the end.
Okay, then. So, in the beginning of your estate career, what were the problems you faced like or what were the mistakes you have committed in the very beginning? What were the mistakes?
Real estate, especially in India, is not a regulated business.
Yeah.
Because it is not a regulated business, we don't have a contract with the buyer or the seller. Whatever commitments that is made between the buyer, seller and the facilitator or the broker is only word of mouth. There's nothing in writing. So, you have to depend totally on the client's commitment and hope that he pays you. There are many times when the client has not paid me, in spite of a commitment. Big business. I have spent 6 months in a deal and after that, he didn't pay me. I tried to go after him, but it didn't work out. But I can't keep running after him and lose my other businesses. So, I said, okay, that's the way it is. And I've lost more than about 8-10 lakhs in that. In these kind of runs,
right? So, you're talking about 6 months.
No, that is one deal. That I lost about 2 lakhs, I think. Like that, I have lost about 8-10 lakhs. I have lost
in the beginning of your
career. From the beginning of my career. Then, as far as possible, I try and speak to the client. I tell him, see, this is my fees. Unless I'm convinced that he will pay me, I will not get into the deal.
Okay.
That's how I work. That's something which I learned in the beginning.
So, is there anything else regarding commitment part? Is there anything else other than the people side? Is there anything from the product side that you have learned? Like you had
in this business, most brokers are not transparent.
Mm.
They like to make as much money as possible from somebody else's property, which is not possible.
Mm.
There is a fee, a fixed fee. The buyer should give 1%, the seller should give 2%.
Mm.
If you are expecting more than that from somebody else's capital, it's not fair.
Mm.
But this is what happens.
Mm.
They fix up with the seller for, let's assume they fix it up for 1 crore.
Mm.
They will talk to the buyer for 1.25 crores.
Mm.
Can you make 25% profit on somebody else's? It's not possible.
Mm.
So it doesn't work out.
Mm.
I think we should just be satisfied with that 2% from the seller and 1% from the buyer.
Mm.
Not more than that.
Mm.
And tell them very clearly, transparent transaction, we'll introduce you, we will facilitate the deal, and we'll ensure that it goes to its logical conclusion.
Mm. Okay. So, you have mainly focused on to the residential market.
That's mainly residential, but I don't say no to commercials.
Yeah. I mean, that's what you told me. I mean, that's what we have been talking on the phone.
Yes.
The other night. So, if you take the residential market, you have been from the last 17 years there. The point where you got into the market, exactly speaking. So, how were the fluctuations, ups and downs of Chennai market?
See, there was a boom period.
Mm. During 2000, right?
2009 to 2013, I think, was the boom period.
Mm.
And everything was skyrocketing.
Mm.
From 2,500 rupees a square feet, it went up to 22,000 rupees a square feet.
Mm.
But unfortunately, at that time, the end consumer was not buying the product.
Mm.
It was all speculative buying.
Mm.
People were buying, they wanted to sell, make money and exit.
Mm.
Today it is not so.
Mm.
See, the market is now stabilizing to a great extent.
Mm.
But prices have not come down to the extent that it should come down.
Okay. So your prediction is that it might go still down.
I don't think it will go down.
Mm.
I think it will just, at today's prices, it will just stabilize.
Mm. So, development of Chennai will be adding to that. Do you think that will not be adding up to the...
See, recent demonetization, there was a break in the market.
Mm.
People were not buying.
Mm.
Because they all felt that, it's the end of corruption. There's not going to be any black money.
Mm.
But that is not so.
Mm.
Today also there is black money.
Mm.
Black money is it's a journey of... that money which travels from one person to another, in between becomes black from white, white to black, black to white. That's how it happens.
Mm.
Today also people take black money
in
the real estate sector. I don't think it is the end of black money.
So do you think water problems in Chennai? Recent that are trying to, a bit growing of water problems. So do you think that will affect the Chennai housing market?
No, it will not.
It will not affect. I mean, reason like why it will not affect?
Everybody has to buy a house.
Mm.
So why should it affect? Whether there is water or no water, they have to buy a house.
Mm. Seeing on a practical scale that what you are saying is...
See, water cannot be a reason for housing sector not taking off, because water they have to get from somewhere.
Mm.
If there is no groundwater,
mm.
they have to get water from outside.
Mm.
And fill up their sums.
Mm.
So ultimately, they have to live in a house. So they have to buy.
Mm.
There will be a demand for properties.
Mm.
See, if you look at the outskirts, there is a very high unsold inventory.
Mm.
But you look at the city,
there
is no unsold inventory in the city. City is all full.
Mm.
They are selling whatever they are making.
Mm.
Outside, yes, it's there.
Mm. Okay, so then we'll come to a different side. So what advice will you give to someone like me, who is almost one third of your age, not even one third, less than, a bit less than one third of your age?
My advice would be that there needs to be total transparency in any transaction that you make.
Mm.
Be honest to both the buyer and the seller.
Mm.
You cannot take sides.
Mm.
You ensure that there is a reasonable negotiation for both sides.
Mm.
The seller cannot take the buyer for a ride, and the buyer should not think that, you know, he can fleece the seller because he is in a desperate need to sell.
Mm.
We should be facilitators who can balance the need and the supply and ensure that a reasonable transaction takes place.
Mm.
That's why we need to play a role.
Yeah.
Otherwise, what is the need for a broker?
Mm.
Go and say that, yeah, that is available. No, that is not the role.
Mm.
The role is to ensure that we facilitate right from the time that we show him the property till the time he goes to the register office and registers the property in his name. Our role ends only after that, not before that.
So what kind of, so final question, what kind of impact do you want to have on people around you?
I want people to remember me as a very honest broker, an honest facilitator who has helped them to create wealth within themselves by ensuring that they buy a property. So that they can talk about me to somebody else and tell them, you want to buy a property, go to Ashok.
Mm.
He will help you to buy a property at very reasonable cost, reasonable rates, transparent. He will not take you for a ride. That is very important in the real estate market, which is absent in many, many places.
So do you try to continue relationships with the past buyers or past sellers? Is there anything like that?
I have more than about 250 clients who come back to me, who I may have forgotten, they have not forgotten.
Okay.
They come back to me.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir.
Welcome, Bamsi. Thank you very much for thinking that I'm an expert in the business. I'm really not an expert, but definitely I have gone through the grind. I have gone through the journey. And I think real estate is a good business to be in. I think only we need to be very careful in how we handle our business. The other factor which is very important in the real estate business is many brokers don't keep timing. If they say, I'm going to meet you at 10 o'clock, they should be there at 9:45. They come only at 10:15, which is not correct. The client can come late. You cannot go late. You have to be there in time. So please be there on time. Ensure that you satisfy your client to the best possible manner. And see that you give him a good deal.
So any of the people who want to reach you, how can they reach you? I mean, is it online or offline? How is it?
They can reach me online or they can reach me
So is there a website?
I had a website. I'm not... I've disbanded the website.
Fine. We'll find put out the details on the show. That's fine.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you so much, sir.